Good morning, everyone. It's great to be here. I would like to thank Megan for organizing the session, and we really sorry that she couldn't make it today, but cool. So today I would like to talk to you. I would like to talk to you about our purpose in digital archaeology, in digital bioarchaeology, and the ethical sharing of the 3D imaging of the human design. As Colleen Morgan highlighted last year at the we might consider ourselves cyborgs whose lives are entwined with digital technology. Now our research captures 3D data in a mesh of pixels, spanning landscapes, sites, and artifacts using anything from laser scanners to stereoscopic digital views. And as archaeologists, our work includes the digitization of the analog dead. Those who never had a digital record and whose data are now regularly sharing online in the form of 3D images and modeling. Such a sharing has been termed digital public mortuary archaeology, or DPMA, referring to the creation and engagement with any digital content concerning the dead, including platforms such as blogs, and Twitter, as well as video games. Digital 3D models of human remains are shared online on platforms such as Sketchfab, Morphosource, and institutional pages such as Smithsonian X3D, as well as through publishing sites such as IIG's Visual Media Service. However, the breakneck speed of the digital revolution has meant that until recently we have had little time to catch up with the impact of the many changes in the way we work and share bioarchaeological data, and this raised many challenges, including recording, sharing, and storing. But most importantly, we are also concerned with ethics, privacy, and security of the data of the dead, and how they are presented online. The debate over the ethical best practices in recording, sharing, and storing data relating to remains played out online in workshops and conferences as HEA 2013, BAA 2015, for example, and along in a long day, early weekend in 2016, I was experimenting with the Google Sheets capability to analyze HTML and XML, and decided to do this to reveal the characteristics of a set of 165 public available models from Sketchfab, which I had begun creating. And my goal was to assess the usage of online platforms for sharing human remains and understand whether we apply ethical best practices. At the time, Sketchfab was rapidly evolving as one of the most popular platforms for sharing 3D models of humanity, and I felt the results were relevant enough to present at the Digital Archaeological Ethics Sessions at Walk Aid in 2016 and at CEA 2017. So what I define research on Sketchfab data, what it showed in 2016. Showed that, well, many models of human remains on the platform had almost no contextualizing data. 56% of the models were described in the 256 character text field, and some were inside the door. Of this, 19 included a link to external science information, but however, 44 featured no description. For the most, some had thousands of view and are available to reuse, modification, and public download. And this was an issue that needed and still needs addressing. The dilemma was greater than to share or not to share. Human remains, will we share? What we need to work on is when, where, and how best to share. So to support this, I reveal a collection of guidelines for information digitization, copyrights, storage, dissemination, and ethics by selecting a set of keywords to analyze their frequency using volume tools. The results indicated that many guidelines were developed for different purposes and felt very few directly addressed the ethics of digitization or digital archaeology. The symposium at ACCA, WACA 8, on digital archaeology ethics attempts to address this, and the researchers published in the World Archaeologist in 2008, and many more research has contribute to the debate and discussions on best practice in data acquisition, sharing, and scholars since then. One of the outputs of the session at WACA was the resolution on digital archaeological data, which was published as part of the proceedings and was one of the four documents to directly address the subject, although this was more of a summary rather than a detailed note. However, through the literature for digital ethics, visual media and museums and studies, one of the most important aspects which we must address is the requirement for consent from affected communities. Consent is not always straightforward on the subject, other than for museums, plays, our parent outlined in 2011, how contextualization becomes even more important in those situations. Display of material lacking consent should be well contextualized and attempt to trace or account the lack of tracing of consent. With this element in mind, digital archaeologists should aim to capture site provenance and specific archaeological information as metadata whenever the human remains are digitized and shared. To address this issue around sharing and particularly contextualization, I elaborate a matrix to assess for assessment of how and when digital representations of the dead might be displayed online. The variables for assessment fall into broad categories. Firstly, as we can see, situation variables, which include consultation, local legislation, and contextual discretion. In the analysis, are nature-related variables, the identification and state of the individual, circumstance, and times of death. This was also published to our creative outputs as a guide to support the ethical creation of digital archaeological data. But how these discussions and debate influence digital archaeological practice? Have research probes changed? To find an answer, I went back to Sketchfab specifically to look for new data online process for recording and sharing human remains and compare this to the results of 2016. What I found was promising. There are several good examples of models uploaded more recently which provide improved contextualization in the description field. For example, this model by Professor Dominique Collison to the left. But also researchers go beyond them, including links to more information and included embedded imagery and videos, external excavations and the context of the remains. In the example from Ticket Ventures, we also see more warning around the fact that the human remains are displayed, although the model has to be open to see it, which indicates the researchers are more frequently considering the fact of sharing the information online. Overall, when I compare the percentage of the basic data, such as including contextualized information in the description box and links for more information, there is a big difference between the two samples. The original collection models had not been significantly updated, and almost half of the contextualized information, none. On the other hand, many of the new models, which were only sampled, have more links to other information and much more description of what the remains are, where they're coming from, and where they are posted. Gaps are similar made, for example, there are no drawings relating to the persistent archive data and the lack of statements indicating discussions with associated communities or stakeholders, but at least there is some more contextualized information being provided on a regular basis. So SketchUp has also supported some of this change through the introduction of the forms, improved forms of submission of data, which with indicators of data completeness, for example, as well as blog posts providing tips on the best practices for working with the heritage datasets, although non-archaeological data in this case. So in this period, other developments have taken place. Companies such as Sketchfab and Google have attempted to partner with cultural heritage institutions and museums in ways to provision the platform where the data sets will be consumed in the future. Sketchfab creates a series of blog posts and attractive features for cultural heritage institutions, and Google have extended their arts and culture platform. Sketchfab originally offered free premium membership to cultural institutions and now offering 50% discount rate for the ability to load more models and store more data. There has been a proliferation of other 3D platforms as well, 3D and VR technology. They have become more prevalent. For example, Microsoft launched their Windows 3D platform, and Google launched Google Poly, which are competitors to SketchFab. And these platforms present more areas where we might see this misuse of human remains. I found one example on Google Poly where Pascal used for medical teaching had been 3D scans and that available to remix into other 3D work. As you can see on the right, it has been embedded into different types of models and in a way that could be considered analytical. So these platforms now present further challenge for the ethical practices of digital archaeology. Data administrators will need to continue to consider licensing models, including whether downloading and printing is permitted and ensuring that open formats should be selected where possible to promote the interoperability. And we must also consider the persistence of technology, quantities of data such as 3D mesh and texture files often require long-term hosting and storage plans at a significant cost. Otherwise, the digital debt might suffer a second. This brings us to the fundamental question about the choices we make here about data publication. Who owns the infrastructure we are using? And what their policies and practices? I mentioned Google Arts and Culture on early slides, and they had recently partnered with digitalization groups such as SciArc to provision data sets from 3D scanning projects, which SciArc has completed in first on Google Arts and Culture, and now more recently in the form of Open Data Web Portal Plus catalog called Open Heritage 3D, run by a group of heritage organizations partnered with Google Poland, called the Open Heritage Alliance. This is a really initiative that we need to ask ourselves, this is what we want? Can we hold these platforms to account? Can we trust them to our data? Or are they at the money opportunity or way to improve the corporate image? For example, with Google, we have no say over which service survive or are killed. There are infrastructures in place which allow us to manage and use open source standards and software providing interoperability, while also enabling more important features in terms of archaeological metadata. These include solutions like the ADS or Open Context or even Ariadne's viewing visual media service, all of which now have 3D model viewers enabled using open source technology, which is also possible to upload to preservation repositories such as Zenodo and receive permanent DOIs for citation. All of these points are highly important to platforms to ensure that data is interoperable. Contextualized and managed by archaeologists. However, beyond this point, we also need to understand the objectives of each project and how the funding model might have an influence on remains, how they are shared, how the remains are shared. So for example, here, research-led excavations are often funded by academic research projects and might have a clear research output and guidelines for documentation and analysis. Developer-led project might not. Has been remaining in the great literature, although these are notable examples such as the MassFarm project, which did a fantastic job with the digitization management. Now, there is a third type of project, a crowdfunded initiatives which are standardized towards consumers. We must therefore consider the impact of these consumers, their expectations of the excavation experience, and the implications they have for ethical use of imagery, digitization, and archaeological sites. So, in summary, from this small survey of data and review of the development in the recent 3 years, it appears that we are making progress, which is good, getting better at managing these issues, and we are still, of course, we still have room to improve, and the digitization of the analog debt. It's vital for greater reflexivity in archaeological fieldwork, enriching past excavation analysis, and offering more opportunities to immersive and interactive engagement. but we must strive for more strategically planned integrated verbs, conducting in a manner synergistic to the feelings of the deceased and the communities involved. To come to conclusions on acceptable use, the engagement of all the stakeholders in the decision is ideal but complicated. Our next steps towards a more ethical digital ecology must be to continue to raise awareness of those issues and more closely engage local communities in our projects. Thanks for listening.